Hello, my name is Emily, and this month on Hello Hemlock, we're talking about Tomson Highway's Kiss of the Fir Queen. Last month, in his video about Man, Jason talked about how it was a book that he loved so much that the moment he put it down, he started reading it again. And for me, reading Tomson Highway's Kiss of the Fir Queen was the same experience. The story begins in northern Manitoba on Mystic Lake, in the land of snow and of caribou, and we meet two brothers there, Champion and Onimitu, as they're known in that environment. And as the story progresses, we follow the two brothers as they move first from northern Manitoba to the residential schools set up by the Roman Catholic Church, and then to Winnipeg, and ultimately to kind of the southernmost metropolis of Canada, to Toronto. And as it tracks this movement, we see the two brothers having to navigate a different kind of movement, a kind of cultural space that's shifting under these colonial pressures that are still very much a part of what's shaping their lived experiences in Canada. What I found most captivating about the novel was that this kind of shifting cultural space is primarily navigated through art, music in Jeremiah's case, or dance in Gabriel's. And I use those two names because for the most part, those are the names used in the novel. This brings up all sorts of discussions about the naming of things and the borders that we draw through language. Before I talk about music, which is ultimately what I plan to spend most of my time talking about, I did want to touch on language, because there's no getting around it that it plays a huge role in kind of these borders that are put up between cultures, and indeed between the reader and the culture that's kind of going on, especially for me as a non-Cree reader. But the text itself is primarily English, although there are moments of Cree in the novel. You know, as someone who doesn't speak Cree, my options, so to speak, when I came upon these passages were to kind of accept this misunderstanding, my own inability to translate and understand these moments, or to flip to the back where there is a glossary of Cree terms that are used. And so as a reader, there's a very spatial kind of tactile reinforcement of my lack of understanding. I found that a really interesting physical manifestation of the kinds of mistranslations that are going on in the novel.
Gabriel lowered his chalice in host and genuflected gently, his head bent in humble, wordless prayer on the moss. He raised his right hand to his heart, a butterfly hovering over a fireweed. Me a cowboy, me a cowboy, me a Mexican cowboy, he chanted, and he smote his chest, one smite for each cowboy.
In the Roman Catholic Mass, when you get to that point in the Mass, you strike your chest. So through my fault, through my fault, through my most grievous fault, to mea culpa, mea maxima culpa. But even though it's not intended to be a really violent scene, there's still these kind of underpinnings of a kind of cultural violence that's going on. Because on the surface, you see this kind of quite comical mistranslation of mea culpa, and yet these boys are striking themselves. And so there's a real discomfort in that moment, at least for me, because of this kind of chafing of translation, that you get a sense of the really active colonialism that's going on there. And that's just one example of the kind of dialogue that's going on between mistranslation between the Latin of the Roman Catholic Church and the English of the Europeans who have come into Canada, and of the Cree. What I found most interesting about that kind of interaction between languages is that the language that all of this is framed within is Italian. Specifically, the novel is kind of structured through Italian tempo markings. It's set up almost like a musical score would be, not in sections, but in movements. So the first section of the novel before we enter into the world of Mystic Lake, we are met with the first instance of this Italian, of this kind of very musical marking. So it says part one, Allegro ma non troppo. On a very structural level, we as the reader are brought into the landscape of Mystic Lake under a framework of like Western European cultural tradition. There are these kind of subtle senses of the ways that the world they live in has already been shaped by these colonial impulses, and it's through music that this is done. Music has a very kind of utilitarian and organic presence. So this comes out in a few ways, the first of which is in this moment where Jeremiah, or Champion, as he's called in this section of the novel, is playing on the accordion and summoning the caribou for his father.
The three-year-old stretched and pumped the miniature accordion strapped to his chest with such abandon that its squawk was frightful. Somewhere out on that lake, Abraham Okmassis and his team of 8 gray huskies were giving chase, and if Champion performed with sufficient conviction, the Okmassis family would be feasting on fresh hindquarter of young caribou before the sun touched the prong of that first pine tree.
For the short-term survival of his family, for them to eat, they need song. And later, Abraham, who's Champion or Jeremiah's father, really takes pride in the fact that Jeremiah or Champion has this gift of music, because it's the way in which the family's legacy will continue. And so there's kind of these two ways in which music becomes utilitarian for survival both of the family in a very just physical bodily way. They need to eat and they need the music to do that, and also sustaining and prolonging kind of their cultural life. It's not only utilitarian, but it's also organic in that it's encoded in the landscape, characterizing it.
Across the lake, a lone wolf raised its howl, the string of notes arcing in a seamless, infinitely slow, and infinitely sad glissando.
So by imposing this kind of orchestral sensibility onto the land, it makes a colonial claim on it. And that the fact that this binary is laid out in the opening chapters, this binary between music as essential for the survival of his indigenous culture, as well as kind of the means of occupation for the colonizers, you get a sense of kind of this cultural dissonance, this kind of border that Jeremiah is being asked to negotiate. If you'll allow me to beat this music horse even further, the moment where I think this becomes perhaps the most powerful, when music is used not just to characterize the landscape, but to negotiate it.
Played the loon cry, the wolves at nightfall, the aurora borealis in Mystic Lake. He played the wind through the pines, the purple of sunsets, the zigzag flight of 1,000 white arctic terns, the fields of mauve-hued fireweed rising and falling like an exposed heart. Jeremiah clung to the ivory until his knuckles equaled them in whiteness. These weren't keys on a piano, but a length of curved, peeled spruce, the handlebar of a sled. Mist rose, silence paralyzed the air. Where was he? What was that? The cracking of the spring ice on Mystic Lake?
So as he enacts this kind of tonal shift, he also enacts a shift of space whereby he moves out of the concert hall and back to Mystic Lake, back to northern Manitoba. And in this way, he kind of reclaims that land, in a sense. He's using the very music that characterized kind of the colonial occupation of that landscape to bring himself back there and to experience a kind of homecoming. And indeed later, towards the end of the novel, he kind of reclaims it even further.
Jeremiah banged at the piano, dissonance like shards of steel, though he had no idea why. And one by one, the company fell in with the chant, a dance, a Cree rite of sacrifice, swirling like blood around the altar and bouncing off the base of the piano, like, yes, magic.
He doesn't only play Chopin or Rachmaninoff, but he pounds it and he plays it, reveling in the dissonance of it. In that way, Jeremiah does indeed use music to carry forward the legacy of his father and his grandfather and his great-grandfather, as Abraham says that he will. Highway himself is a musician, which I think really plays to the strength of the novel. Bad pun. He uses it kind of as a space in which Jeremiah navigates these kind of cultural shifts that he's being asked to navigate. and he kind of takes it out of the, you know, the direct landscape of Canada and puts it onto this kind of more musical frontier, which I think is a really interesting way of exploring it, and that's one of the many things that I loved about this novel. There are obviously huge conversations to be had about this novel that I have hardly touched on. I haven't really talked about residential schools at great length, nor have I talked about kind of the conversations about sexuality that go on in the novel, and I think both of those things are without a doubt important to talk about, but for the sake of timeliness, I will leave it at that. Those are definitely wonderful conversations to have in the comments below, or perhaps for Jason and Jess to introduce in their videos if they are so inclined. If you haven't read this book, I really encourage you to. I know when we talk about these issues, it seems like it would be heavy, but it was such a delight to read. I think because of Highway's deftness with his pen, it's beautifully written, and it reads so well. And I feel like you'd enjoy it, probably. I'd put money on that. There's a Hello Hemlock website now, so if you haven't seen that, you should probably go. Jess has a wonderful piece up there about Joseph Boyden, so go check that out as well. I'll put links in the description. Okay, thanks.
Hey everyone, it's Jessica, and
the Canadian tag.